students. Shall we start the last chapter? That is, I'm going to discuss the entire parasitology in one go. That is, we have already discussed the revised, so we'll be discussing only what are the important questions in 2 months and why I'm viable. And also in the next class, I'll be discussing complete lab diagnosis revision. So in this parasitology, if you listen to this class, you can cover almost in this class I'll be concentrating mainly on the tumors and viva question. It will be just a brushing up of the entire parasitology, and in the second class I will be discussing the lab diagnosis. One good news for you is today you will not have exam in the afternoon. So complete parasitology discussion today. First we'll discuss general topics, next the lab diagnosis. Mainly the commonly asked questions, mainly the 2 marks. If you want, I'll share this PowerPoint to you so that it will be useful to just revise before the exam. There will be questions displayed first, then the answer will be displayed. So meanwhile, before the answer displays, you think of the answers so that it will be like an interactive session, not like a monotonous lecture. Okay, so let us start. First, what are parasites? What classification you have? One is the protozoans, which are unicellular organisms, and the multicellular organisms or the helminths. So among the protozoans, there are 4 classes. What are they? Amoeba, flagellates, apicomplex, or ciliates. What is the division protocol for this? It is mainly on the locomotory organelles. You know that amoeba is by pseudopodia, flagellates by flagella, apicomplex no locomotory organelles, and the ciliates is by cilia. Tell me some amoebae, what are important for us? Mainly the pathogenic ones. You know, first one is Entamoeba histolytica. Other Entamoeba, you know, what are the free living amoebae? There is Gloria fowleri, Acanthamoeba, Sarpinia. These are also present. Coming to the flagellates. Among the flagellates, you know, what are the different flagellates? Name them. First one is the intestinal flagellates. That is Giardia. Next, genital flagellate. Which is the genital flagellate? It is Trichomonas vaginalis. And what are the hemoflagellates, you know? These are Trypanosoma and Leishmania species. There are several Trypanosoma species, you know, Krugozi, Gambiense, and all. I'm just giving the headings, name of the headings, what we have in the parasitology. Coming to the apicomplexa. In the apicomplexa, we have sporozoans and the coccidian parasites. That is, first apicomplexa means apical complex is present. First comes in your mind in apicomplexa is the hematozoa or the sporozoa, which is first is the plasmodium species, right? In among the hematozoans, which is closely resembling to plasmodium, we have learned it is Babesia, right? And what are the other coccidia? We know coccidian parasites, which are more common in HIV, right? What are that? First comes the Cryptosporidium porvum. HIV, unicellular protozoan in HIV, first name you should get is Cryptosporidium porvum. Next, Toxoplasma. Next, Cyclospora, Isospora, Sarcocystis. These are all coccidian belonging to apicomplexa, common in the HIV, right? Coming to the ciliates. Which is the common ciliate, you know? It is Bellenterium coli. Only one ciliate which has the same resemblance in the life is pathogenesis or life cycle similar to that of amoeba. no other intermediate host, you know all these things, it is an important parasite, Velentinium coli. So this is among the protozoans, all unicellular organisms, will they have eggs or cyst? They have cyst in the life cycle, which are the resistant form, which will be the usual mode of transmission from one person to one host to other host. And they don't have eggs. Eggs usually for the helminths, that is multicellular organisms present in the protozoans. What are the different helminths we know? Cestodes, trematodes, nematodes. What is the common name for cestodes? It is tapeworm, because their body is like tape, measuring tape. So it is called as cestodes. Trematodes are also known as flukes, because their body is leaf shape, and nematodes are also known as roundworms, because they are cylindrical in shape, right? Now name some cestodes. The first cestode you know is longest cestode, or the largest pathogenic cestode, is Staphylobothrium latum, Tinea solium, Tinea saginata, which causes teniasis, even cysticercosis by both. Echinococcus granulosus, if you know that, Hymenolepis nana. These are the important cestodes we have learnt in parasitology. Different tapeworms. Coming to the trematodes, what are the different flukes we have learnt? Cystosomus rhesus, facial hepatica, facial clonarchis sinensis, facial abscess busky. Next, Paragonimus westermanni. These are the important trematodes which are pathogenic and which are important for in the flukes. Coming to the nematodes, there are two types, intestinal nematodes and which are present in the tissues. Yesterday we have learnt about the tissue nematodes. What are intestinal nematodes? First comes the our roundworm. The name nematodes is also called a roundworm, and the first representative is the Ascaris. Others are Ankylostoma diurnal, Necator, Strongyloides, Strepcoralis, common in the HIV, Trichuris trichura, Entrobius vermicularis. And the somatic nematodes are, yesterday you have learnt in the class. What are the somatic nematodes? The first, filarial worms. What are the filarial worms? You know, the Bucheraria branchafti and Brugia malayi. Others like Lova lova, Oncocerca volvulus, Dracunculus medinensis, Trichinella spiralis. These are the, and even the Mansonella are all nematodes which are mainly somatic. So till now we have seen the headings of the chapters, what we have learnt in the parasitology and what we have discussed already. These are the names. Now coming to the questions. What are the common names? I have given the common names. Tell me what are these actual names of these organisms, or scientific name of these organisms, which is called as grand old man of the intestine. Tell me, which is called as grand old man of the intestine? It is Giardia lamblium. Which is known as dwarf tapeworm? Dwarf tapeworm, it is Hymenolepis nana. High-headed worm, you know already, it is Echinococcus. It is an important question even in the medicine. There was a 4-mark question, high-headed worm, high-headed cyst was the 4-mark question. So you need to write the Echinococcus granulosus. Which is the longest tapeworm? Just now I told. Which is the longest tapeworm? It is Staphylobothrium latum. It is all as long as even 9 meters. Coming to the blood fluke. Which is known as blood fluke? There are 3 blood flukes. You know what are that? Cystosoma hematobium, Cystosoma mansoni, Cystosoma japonicum, which are important for us. And what are the liver flukes? One is sheep liver fluke, other is Chinese liver fluke. What is sheep liver fluke? This is commonly asked question, because it is a spotter also for you. In viva, generally even in the questions also you have written in the last Tuesday's exam, Chinese liver fluke was a question. So it may be asked as directly as a question, 2-mark question, or it is definitely asked in the viva, any one of you. So what are that? Sheep liver fluke is facial hepatica, and Chinese liver fluke is colonarchis sinensis. Coming to the intestinal fluke. There are several intestinal flukes present, among which the important for us is facial abscess Buschke. Others like heterophis, Watsonia, heterophis, gastroid, discoides, these are so many intestinal flukes are present. Coming to the lung fluke, which is important lung fluke, which causes endemic hemoptysis, we have already discussed. What is that? It is Paragonimus westermoni, which is roundworm. All the nematodes are called roundworms, but except one specific nematode is called as roundworm, which is Ascaris lumbricoides, which are hookworms. Hookworms which causes anemia. What are that hookworms? These are ankylostoma and nicator. And just giving the common names, all the questions which already you know, so just revise so that it will be easy for you to for the parasitology. Even in the while writing the 2 marks or 4 marks or even essays also, you need to mention these keywords, because these will be the important ones. So I'm just going on with the questions and answers. What are the pinworm, which is called as pinworm or threadworm, is also called as seed worm. What is that? It is Enterobius, which is called filarial worm, the tissue nematode, or the somatic nematode, which is the Bucareria bancrofti or the Burkia mallei. Coming to the whip worm, which is whip worm, it is also one of the stool examination for you. It commonly asked, what is Trichuris tritura, and what is dragon worm or medina worm? Yesterday we have discussed it is Dracunculus medinensis. Important question even in recent PG, which was PG exam conducted, microbiology PG exam conducted last 2 months back. In that, the 10 marks question was asked about Dracunculus medinensis, because it is the only parasite which is eradicated, we could successfully eradicate. Right? Coming to the diseases, names and organisms. Till now we have seen the common names and organisms. Now tell me, what are the different diseases and what are the organisms? Ancovis aspas, where it is seen? It is seen in amoebic liver abscess, right? Amoebic liver abscess is caused by which organism? It is Entamoeba histolytica. In the extra intestinal, which is mainly the liver which is affected, causing it. Amoebic liver abscess, the characteristic pus is called as Ancovis aspas. That is favorite question, Ancovis aspas. These are the usual viva questions I'm asking here. Mainly the MIVA questions and important keywords in the answers. Where do you see strawberry vagina? It is a disease condition where it is seen. Only one parasite is seen in the genital tract, causing genital infection, that is Saccharomyces vaginalis. Which causes sleeping sickness? It is Trypanosoma gambiense. Chagas disease. Chagas disease, favorite PG entrance question also. Which causes Chagas disease? It is by Trypanosoma cruzi. Which causes Kalaajar? It is Leishmania donovani. Which causes Delhi boils or Oriental sore or Alappi boils? There are several names for it. Or tropical ulcer. This is the Leishmania tropica. Coming to black water fever. Which organism causes this condition? It is a complication of malaria seen in Plasmodium falciparum, right? Remaining all names in the complication, you will see algid malaria, pernicious malaria, malaria will be seen. So they will ask this type of question so that it will be a best assessment, so that you will, if you answer it, you know the malaria completely. Neurocystis are causes. Already know ethemia sodium or cyanogenin with the sodium. I that is his favorite question, a kind of focus piece, is one of the important essay question or 2 marks or 4 marks question. Swimmer's itch is caused by the larva of Schistosoma species. While bathing, which is the Orthosuccus Sacaria. Bacteria larva enters the man. There, there will be itch. So it is called as swimmer's itch. It's called commonly seen caused by Schistosomiasis, mainly the larva. Coming to endemic hematuria. Where do you see hematuria? The same Schistosoma hematopoeia, because it is present in the pelvic plexus. It is releasing the urine in the eggs in along with the urine, so blood is also released. It is called as endemic hematuria. One more question here. It is endemic hemophysis. This is already discussed in last exam also. I have written endemic hemophysis is caused by Paragonimus westermoni, which causes ground itch. So there are two itches: swimmer's itch, ground itch. You should not forget. Swimmer's itch is seen in Schistosoma species. Ground itch is by hookworms. What are the hookworms? Ankylostoma and Necrotis. Which causes iron deficiency anemia? Hookworms. Iron deficiency anemia, first name should be hookworm, because after iron deficiency in India, the next common cause for iron deficiency anemia is the hookworm. First thing is deficiency intake of the iron by most of the Indian women of the middle age. The second most common reason for iron deficiency in India is hookworm infection, either by Ankylostoma or Necator. You know where it is present, North India, South India. Coming to the B12 deficiency, even not only in iron deficiency anemia, not only seen in hookworm, that is some important cause. Secondly, you can see in malaria also, even in the Schistosoma species, because it is releasing the eggs with the water. Even in other infections also you will see the anemia, but iron deficiency anemia, but the main cause is the hookworm. First name should be the hookworm when you are asked about the iron deficiency anemia. What about the B12 deficiency anemia? Which causes B12 deficiency anemia? It is Diphyllobothrium latum. Because it is the largest tapeworm, it occupies the complete intestine, and it will not allow the food or absorption of the B12 from the intestine. That is why it is causing the B12 deficiency anemia, which is important. Last time also there was a question: anemia causing cis organism in among the cystos and trematodes. This is the important one, Diphyllobothrium latum. Larva currents. Which causes larva currents? It is by Strongyloides staphylorhalis, which causes larva currents. Which causes river blindness? River blindness is caused by Onchocerca volvulus. It is one of the parasitic causes of blindness. Usually we mistake blindness for lova, because it is called as eye worm. But lova is present in eye, but it will not cause blindness. Onchocerca is a major cause of the blindness among this parasites. Coming to the Calabar swelling is present in lova, because it is a subcutaneous swelling near the eye. Yesterday we have discussed this. And the tropical pulmonary dysnophilia is caused by the filarial worms, where it is present occult in the lungs. It causes occult filariasis, which is tropical pulmonary dysnophilia. There is one more condition called as low flow syndrome. We'll discuss it, because it is not by single organism. We will discuss as a 2 marks question after this, right? So these are the diseases and organisms. Coming to the organ and the parasites, in which organs the parasites are present. Mainly parasites infection means we'll think about the gut, either small intestine or the large intestine. Even the parasites may be present in other organs also, but the main ones are the small intestine and large intestine. Which are the organisms present in the small intestine? The most of the organisms, starting from the, tell me, from the protozoans to nematodes. First, in the protozoan, which is more common, the Giardia. And is Entrobius present in the small intestine? It is not present in the small intestine, present in the large intestine. So Giardia is first, next Cryptosporidium, Cyclospora, Isospora. These are all present in the small intestine. and all the this tapeworms, Diphyllobothrium, Tinea and all present except the Echinococcus, because it is not present in man as a main host. In dog it is present in the small intestine only, but remaining all the cystos are present in the small intestine of man. And all the intestinal flukes, whatever we have discussed, that is facial abscess is the main one, vasomia, heterophis, these are all present in the small intestine except gastrodiscoides. Where it is present in the intestine, but it is present in the large intestine. And what are the nematodes present in the small intestine? These are Ascaris, Ankylostoma, Necator. An important one, especially asked, is this question. Which is the protozoan present in the large intestine? Which is the protozoan present in the small intestine is the question. That is Giardia. Which is the cestode present? No cestode in the large intestine. Which is the trematode present in the large intestine? Only one, that is gastrodiscoides. And which is the nematodes present? Which are the nematodes present in the large intestine? It is Enterobius, Vermicularis, and Treacherous. This is the commonly asked question, because Enterobius and Treacherous are given in your stool examination also. So this is a commonly asked question: which are the nematodes present in the large intestine? All the nematodes, intestinal nematodes, are present in the small intestine except Enterobius, Vermicularis, and Treacherous, Trichura. These are the present in large intestine. So all the flukes except this gastrodiscoides, all the intestinal flukes are present in the small intestine, and all the nematodes are present in the small intestine except Enterobius and Treacherous. These are the commonly asked question. Coming to the liver, first you know which comes in liver: Echinococcus, even Entamoeba in extra intestinal migration, and amoebic liver abscess will be present. Facial and clonarthritis are nothing but the liver flukes. Coming to the lungs, even Echinococcus may come into the lung, amoeba can come into the lung, but commonly asked is the Paragonimus westermoni, is the main lung fluke. Coming to the brain which goes our free living amoebae, Naegleria floreri, Acanthamoeba, even the Trypanosoma, sleeping snakes, because it affects the brain. Then Toxoplasma, you can see the cyst, tachyzoids moving around, and it can go into any organ, especially in the HIV individuals, they move to the brain. We have seen a CT scan picture also. Coming to the Tinea solium, the cysticercosis, neurocysticercosis is caused by Tinea solium, that is the brain. Coming to the muscle, which are present, especially the somatic nematodes and the even the cysticercosis caused by Tinea. You know the Tinea solium causes two types of infection. One is Teniasis, other is cysticercosis. Teniasis, it present in the intestine, whereas cysticercosis, it is present in the muscle or in the brain, especially in solium. It causes disease in the neurocircus, cysticercosis. These are the important organs and the parasites present in it. Coming to the routes of entry of the parasites into the man, fecal-oral route, almost all the intestinal or the fecal contaminants or the parasites in the intestine are co-transmitted by fecal-oral route. The major, you know all these things: Entamoeba, Balanitherium, Giardia, Tinea, Ascaris, Enterobius, Treacherous, Trichinella. Even Trichinella, it is present in the muscle, but it is causing transmitted by fecal-oral route. This is the important question. Which is transmitted by blood transfusion? So what are the organisms which are transmitted by blood transfusion? First is the Plasmodium, which you know malaria is also transmitted by blood. Trypanosoma cruzi also. Which is transmitted by congenital route? It is the main important one. Congenital toxoplasma. In the entire parasitology, congenital syndromes is seen mainly in the toxoplasma. Others are also transmitted, but congenital toxoplasma syndrome, we have learnt about the congenital syphilis syndrome, congenital rubella syndrome. These are all present among the torch infections. T stands for toxoplasma. It is here in the parasitology. Which is transmitted by skin or direct penetration? This is also very, very important ask question. Ankylostoma, hookworm, is transmitted not by fecal oral route, though it is present in the small intestine. it is not transmitted by fecal oral route, it is by direct penetration, where we have asked what is ground itch also. The ground itch is by hookworm. The skin iron deficiency anemia is by hookworm. Small intestine is present is hookworm. And the mode of transmission is by direct penetration, it is hookworm. So important points in the hookworm we have covered. Strongyloides also is by direct penetration, same as hookworm. And schistosoma species also we have learnt swimmer's itch. Coming to the bite of the insects. Bite of the insects, first you know the Plasmodium, Leishmania, Wuchereria, Brugia, even the lower, all the filarial worms, where it is by Culex, Plasmodium by this mosquitoes, Leishmania is by this sandfly, Oncocerca, black fly, Trypanosoma, CC fly, Babesia by this rat fly. By sexual contact, only one organism, you know, it is Trichomonas vaginalis. Even Entamoeba and Giardia also can be transmitted. The main one is Trichomonas vaginalis. Tell me, what are the infections which are by auto-infection? What are the parasites transmitted by auto-infection? Now, it is one of the important two-mask question or the viva question. Which organisms first comes the Strongyloides subcoralis? Especially in the HIV individuals, it is more come. And the thing is auto-infection, the Strongyloides, other one is Cryptosporidium parvum also, Entrobius vermicularis, mainly in children because of improper hygiene, and others is also Hymenaeal lupus nana also, it can be transmitted by auto-infection. So first thing to be remembered is the Strongyloides, second is Entrobius, next comes the Cryptosporidium and Hymenaeal lupus. And other question, parasites in HIV. Now tell me, because if you are asked direct question, parasite in HIV, because any parasite can affect the HIV individual because they are immunocompromised. You should name them which are mainly non-infectious or not having symptoms when it is present in non-HIV individuals and have a highly symptomatic present in HIV individuals. The first one comes in the protozoans is the Cryptosporidium. Next, Cyclospora, Isospora, these are all the apicomplexa group. Among those, first is next Toxoplasma. Even Leishmania causes severe disease in HIV. Amoeba also causes severe disease in HIV, but you should not name them, it is directly asked. You should tell the which are the clear parasites in HIV. Next, Microsporidium, Nemocystis, Strongyloides. In among the nematodes, if you ask the protozoans, the first should be the name should be Cryptosporidium. Among the nematodes or the helminths, the first name should be Strongyloides. Coming to the samples and the parasites. Till now we have seen the organs and the parasites, mode of transmission, what are the common names and all. Now we'll discuss what are the different samples and what are present in the different each sample. So what are the trophozoites? That means what are the nematodes present, what are the protozoans present in the feces? We have collected for the diagnostic purpose, two sample is sent. So what organisms you are expecting in this? The trophozoites is mainly the Entamoeba, Giardia, Plantidium, Trichomonas, Hominis, not the genitalis. Hominis is the genital parasite. So leave about that Trichomonas. Remember Entamoeba, Giardia, Plantidium, and the same thing in the cystodes. Coming to the adult worms, which adult worms can be seen in the feces? One is Ascaris, Entrobius, and facial abscess. Whisky, that is nematodes. And adult worm segments of the adult worms, especially the cestodes, you will see the segments. These segments, that is Tenosolium paginata and Aequilobotrium, you will see the adult worm segments. Coming to the eggs, almost all the helminths which are present in the intestine, Cystosoma species, facial abscess, Clonarchis, even the liver flukes, all the nematodes, Ascaris, Ankylostoma, Entrobius, Trichuris, all these all the different examples with different parasites, plus where you see the eggs in the feces. So where you see the trophozoite cyst, protozoans, adult worms, nematodes, adult worm segments, cestodes, eggs, all the helminths. Coming to the peripheral smear, blood smear. This is all, it is commonly asked question in your viva, which organisms are seen in the peripheral blood smear. Peripheral blood smear, first we will remember the plasmonium species. Even the babesia also comes here, and the hemoflagellates, leishmania, and the trypanosoma, where you will see the mastocyte and the trypanomastocyte in the microphyle area, will be seen in the all the filarial worms. Coming to the bone marrow, liver, lymph nodes, spleen, aspirate. These are present usually, we remember the protozoans. One is the toxoplasma, other is the leishmania donor. In the Kalajar lab diagnosis, samples we have written spleen aspirate, lymph node aspirate, bone marrow aspirate for leishmania donor. Coming to the liver aspirate as such, which trophozoite? It is amoeba, that is Entamoeba histolytica. Lymph node aspirate, we can see the trypanosoma species. In the lymph node biopsy, which adult worm is seen? This is the filarial worm, Bucheraria bancrofti and Bruglia malayi. Which is present in CSF? CSF, which trypomastigote is seen in the CSF? That sleeping trypanosoma gambiense. Which larva is present in the CSF? Cysticercosis, that is tinea or angiostrangularis. Even the trophozoites, which trophozoites are seen? They are Naegleria fowleri and Acanthamoeba. These are all the different present in the CSF. Coming to the, what are the important in the urine? This is also peripheral blood smear, urine, and the liver aspirate. These are the three questions which are commonly asked in the viva. Which parasites are seen in the urine? First comes is the trichomonas, next Bucheraria, others the cystozoma. These are the important ones, because these three will be asked definitely. What are the present in urine? Trichomonas in protozoans, Bucheraria, you will see the chyluria, you will see the worms in the urine, and the exocystosoma in the hematuria. Coming to the sputum, which adult worm is seen in the sputum? Paragonimus westermanni, sputum, liver, lung, fluke, paragonimus, even paragonimus, larva. When it is migrating, especially the ascaris, strong anandis ankylostoma, even Entamoeba, when it is having extraintestinal amoebiasis. Coming to the duodenal aspirate, we have seen the entro test, where it is done for Giardia. Even the larva, that is strong Aedes stercoralis, also is seen in liver. Corneal speckings, only one parasite which is present in the eye, it is Acanthamoeba species. Which is present in the skin? Even the leishmania, especially the tropical ulcers, that is tropical Delhi boils, and the microfilaria, volvulus is seen in the micro. You will see the subcutaneous nodules or the discoloration in onchocerca. And the larva and skin ulcers in Dracunculus meninensis. We have seen the with the stick they used to make withdraw the parasite. Slowly by day they will be removing the parasite in Dracunculus skin ulcers. The muscle tissue, trichinella spiralis, and in cysticercosis, tinea. Perianal area, the main one is the entrobius. Coming to the intermediate host in the life cycle. No intermediate host, we have discussed all these organisms previously also, which do not have intermediate host, that is man is only definitive host. No other intermediate hosts, you know, the Entamoeba histolytica, Giardia, Trichomonas, Valentidium, Cryptosporidium, Hemanolepis nana, Ascaris, Ankylostoma, Necate, Strongylaris, Entrobius, Trichuris. These are the parasites which do not have, man is the only host. One intermediate host is present other than man. So man is the definitive host and one intermediate host is present. Where it is present? Leishmania species, sandfly, Trypanosoma cruzi, what is the intermediate host? Redovid bug. Trypanosoma gammiensis, CC fly, Tinea solium, pig. Tinea saginata, it is cattle. Hymenolepis, rat flea. Cystosoma, snail. Trichinella spiralis, pig. Filarial worms, mosquito, the culex, and the others. Oncocerca, black fly. Lova lova, deer fly. Ratunculus, it is cyclops. This last one is the important favorite question of our FHOD sir also, which is the which parasite intermediate host is cyclops. This is the favorite question, that is Ratunculus, right? Man has an intermediate host, not the definitive host. Others are the definitive host, but man will be the intermediate host. Where it is present, first is the Plasmodium, where the mosquito is the definitive host, female Anopheles mosquito. Man is intermediate. Even Babesia also, Toxoplasma, where cat is the definitive host and man is the intermediate host, Sarcocystis, Echinococcus, dog is the main host, Tinea. In cysticercosis, man is the both definitive host, even intermediate host. If it is a definitive host, he will get teniasis. If he is intermediate host, he will get cysticercosis. Two host. What are the two host? Man will be the definitive host. And what are the two hosts? Diphyllobothrium, cyclops, and fish will be the definitive intermediate host. Facial hepatica, snail, and aquatic plant. And even facial abscess, snail, and aquatic plant. In cystosoma, only one intermediate host, only snail. Whereas in other flukes, two intermediate hosts present, like faciola, facial abscess, clonarchis, snail and fish. Paragonimus, snail and fish or crab. Coming to the eggs. This is again you have learnt in the stool examination also. Commonly asked question, what are non-biased NX and what are biased NX? Biased NX or Ascaris, Trichuris, Tinea solium, Tinea saginata, clonarchis, faciola, facial abscess. What are non-biased NX? NEHA, NEHA, Necatera americanus, Entrobius vermicularis, Hymenolepis nana, Ankylostoma leoninal. This is important because if you remember this, you can answer this also. Commonly asked is this, definitely first question in stool examination will be in practicals, the non-biostain X. If it is not asked in practicals, you will be asked in the parasitology viva all. This question, Necator, Entrobius, Hymenolepis, Ankylostoma. That is non-biased NX. One more question. Next common question is, which do not flow in the saturated SAS solution? So first we should know which will float. All the fertilized eggs are Ascaris, Necator americanus, Ankylostoma, Entrobius, Trichuris. Unfertilized eggs sink in the saturated. Whenever you see the flotation technique, saturated SAS solution is used, all should float. But three eggs will sink. What are these three eggs? Unfertilized egg of Ascaris, eggs of Tinea, which are the very large eggs, and eggs of intestinal flukes. What are the intestinal flukes? Facial abscess, atrophis, gastrodiscoides, these are all the eggs. So all this will not float in flotation technique, but others will float. So these three should be remembered mainly. What is the important question is, which do not flow in a saturated SAS solution? It is unfertilized egg of Ascaris, egg of Tinea, and egg of intestinal flukes. Coming to the other question, which are operculated eggs and which are non-operculated eggs? The eggs of all the flukes except cystosoma. Except blood fluke, all the flukes, facial hepatica, facial abscess, clonarchis, paragonimus. And which are non-operculated eggs? So first comes the cystosoma, because all the trematodes are operculated eggs except cystosomes. And the remaining other helminths comes under non-operculated eggs. So all the nematode eggs, all the cestode eggs, all are non-operculated. Only operculated eggs are all the trematodes except the blood flukes. This to be remembered, which are operculated eggs or the flukes except cystosoma. Coming to the more commonly asked, either it is a 4-mark question or a 2-mark question, larva migrans. If you are asked about larva migrants, you need to mention two things: one is cutaneous larva migrants and systemic larva migrants. In this, what is the basic, what is meant by larva migrants and what is cutaneous and systemic, we need to mention. So basically, when where we see larva migrants, when any zoonotic infection affects a man, because the larva randomly moves aimlessly. The correct word is aimlessly moves around when there is a infection to abnormal host. Which is abnormal host here? He is the man, because it is a zoonotic infection occasionally or accidentally coming into the man. So all the zoonotic infections, some even the human infections also show the larva migrants. These are exceptions. First we'll discuss about the zoonotic parasites, then what are the human parasites in each thing. Coming to the cutaneous larva migrants, because the Ankylostoma brasiliensis, Ankylostoma caninum, these are present in cats and dogs. These are the, when enter into the humans, they cause, they move aimlessly in the skin, causing cutaneous larva migrants. But even Strongylaris staphylococcalis, especially present in the HIV individuals, they move to all the organs, even in the skin. In skin, they cause, specifically there it is mentioned as larva currents. And even Ankylostoma, when it is having extra intestinal migration or in the presence of ground itch also, it shows cutaneous larva migrants, both the hookworms. Coming to the systemic larva migrants, it is also first Toxocara canis, Toxocara cati. They are not moving through the skin, they are moving in different organs, because these are zoonotic infections in cat and dogs, but they are affected humans, they are moving aimlessly. Even Angiostrongylus cantonensis also. Even Ascaris in humans, which is a parasite, that is Ascaris, when it is moving in the extra-intestinal migration, they cause the systemic larva migrants. This is about the larva migrants. The same Strongylaris even in the cutaneous or in the visceral. Coming to the parity and then nematodes. Because nematodes, we see some are laying eggs, some are releasing larvae. So this is the favorite question, especially for HOD, sir. What are oviparous, viviparous, ovoviviparous animals? Nematodes especially. Oviparous, or which releases Ascaris, we have seen the eggs, Trichuris, Ankylostoma, Necator, Trichuris, Entrobius. Viviparous, you know, for microphylia, all the somatic nematodes, Eukarya, Brugia, Trichinella, Dracunculus. Whereas ovoviviparous, it is present only in Strongylaris. This is the favorite question, especially if elderly examiners come, this question will be commonly asked. Strongylaris, which is the ovoviviparous animal? Parity means which are releasing ova or the eggs, which are releasing the larva. So oviparous or the intestinal nematodes, viviparous or the somatic nematodes, and ovoviviparous, especially the Strongylaris, you remember. In the microphylia, the somatic nematodes, one more important question, which are sheathed microphylia and which are unsheathed microphylia, which are present in blood and in skin. The Eukarya, Brugia and Lova are sheathed. All the phylaria were mainly the Eukarya, Brugia and the Lova are sheathed. Which are unsheathed, which are present in the blood, are Mansonella, Ojati and Perstans are present in the blood. And Oncocerca and Mansonella streptocerca are present in the skin. Even in the samples also, we have seen which our parasite is present in the skin. Skin is the Oncocerca. Right? This is about the microphylia. Coming to the next question, common parasite causing anemia. These are the two commonly asked, two mass question. One is parasites causing anemia, parasites causing malignancy. What are the parasites causing anemia? I said first iron deficiency anemia and also B12 deficiency anemia. Iron deficiency, first name, that is plasmodium. So according to the order I have written, plasmodium is the protozoan. In the protozoan, plasmodium leishmania, diphyllobothrium in the cestodes, and cystosoma in the trematodes, and hook worm in the nematodes. According to the order, I have written from protozoans to nematodes. So what are the parasites causing anemia? Plasmodium, Leishmania, Dicholoprothium, Cystosoma, Hickworm. What are the parasites causing malignancy? Cystosoma, mainly hematobium causes bladder cancer. Facial hepatica causes liver cancer. Clonorchis, bile duct cancer. Parasites causing myocarditis. This is not usually asked question but rarely asked. Mainly you need to remember trypanosomas. These are the mainly important causes for the myocarditis, Brucia, Brucia. Even other organisms like Toxoplasma, Echinococcus and Trichinella may cause myocarditis. But myocarditis, first remember the name trypanosoma. Parasites causing Loeffler syndrome. So we have learned about the topical pulmonary eosinophilia is caused by occult filariasis. But Loeffler syndrome, especially when the larva is going for extra intestinal migration, they stay back in the lungs releasing the inflammatory substance, especially the Ascaris, migrating larva Ascaris, Ankylostoma, Niketa. And which are the parasites in the present in the lungs? The mainly the lung flu parenchymas, even the echinococcus cause lung cyst, and Entamoeba also affect the lungs. So these are the parasites and these are the migrating larva which causes the Loeffler syndrome. Because they are reaching the lung, they create inflammation and release the sputum with charcoal laden crystals and all will be seen. This is the commonly asked question, Loeffler syndrome. You should write migrating larva, Ascaris, Ankylostoma, Niketa and Strongylides, and the parasites like Echinococcus, Exoparagonimus and Entamoeba. Coming to the next question, what are the parasites can be cultured in the laboratory? Which parasites can be cultured? The parasites, mainly the protozoans. Which protozoans? Entamoeba, Histolytica, we have learnt, Acanthamoeba, Niglaria, Giardia, Leishmania, Anemonium, Trypanosoma, Plasmodium, Artemimedium, Bellanterium also we can culture. So all the parasites which can be cultured in the laboratory or mainly the protozoans. When you see the Strongylides hookworm, they can also be cultured. What we are doing is we are concentrating by the name of the culture. We are concentrating the organisms there. Whatever is present, we are increasing in the number, that is eggs are converted into larva, and we are doing that in the other. But in parasites, in the protozoans, the number is being increased. So main thing we have to write, parasites can be cultured is all the protozoans, Entamoeba, Acanthamoeba, Niglaria, Giardia, these are all the things. Especially the question asked will be for Trichomonas. What is the medium? In pouch medium, diamond medium, these are for Trichomonas. For Leishmania, NNN medium. And for Plasmodium, commonly asked, that is RPMI medium. Motility, this is a WIPA question. Falling leaf motility is seen in Giardia, and twitching motility is present in Trichomonas. And among the motility, it can be asked. Coming to the obligate intracellular parasites. Which are obligate intracellular parasites spotting from the protozoans? Leishmania, Trypanosoma, Plasmodium, even Babesiosis. Skin tests for parasitic infections. What are the different names of the test and what are the organisms? Toxoplasma also is an intracellular parasite, Microsporidia also. Cassini's test for high-directed disease, we do skin test known as Cassini's test. It is also a 2-mark question. Montenegro test is for Kala-Azar. And Fairley's test for cystosomiasis. Frenkel's test for toxoplasmosis. Bachmann test for trichinellosis. These are the skin test. Cassini's test is important and Montenegro is one of the part of the lab diagnosis we have learned. These two are important ones, Cassini's test and Montenegro test. Cassini's test is for hydatidiasis, that is Echinococcus. Montenegro test for Kala-Azar, that is Leishmania. The last one, parasite exhibiting antigenic variation. We have learned the bacteria exhibiting antigenic variation, that is Borrelia recurrentis, and virus causing antigenic variation, we have learned the mainly the influenza. What is a parasite exhibiting antigenic variation? Especially the trypanosoma, Brucei gambiense, Brucei bruciense, even the plasmodium species, sometimes even Giardia also. First name should be remembered in antigenic variation. First name is Trypanosoma brucei. That is about the parasitic infections. In the afternoon class, we'll be discussing about the lab diagnosis in brief. I'll not discuss completely. I'll discuss only in brief. Like this class, we summarize all the lab diagnosis in the afternoon session. There will not be any exam in the afternoon. And you will be having the revision classes of systemic bacteriology from Saturday onwards, so that before your second internal, we can complete mainly all the essay questions of systemic bacteriology before this third week of September. Right? Thank you. No questions today. We'll have the discussion of the lab diagnosis, and later on we can have the questions. Thank you. Any doubts, you can ask me personally, and I'll be ready to discuss.